So we have precautions that we take to help protect you. And most people are going to go through these at some point in their stay. Neutropenic precautions. So when people are neutropenic, earlier I talked about neutrophils, and then we talked a little bit about, well, we didn't, about ANC. So there's something called an absolute neutrophil count. So neutrophils are the little bacteria fighting white blood cells, and they're the fastest reproducing white blood cells. And so we look at them all the time, and you're going to know ANC very, very well by the end of this process. So when your neutrophils are below a certain point, 500 or less, we take neutropenic precautions. The first and best one is always hand washing, and that's 20 seconds full hand washing, singing the ABCs or happy birthday twice. So no contact lenses. We don't want you poking your fingers in your eyes and introducing infections. And then you're going to have your triple lumen catheter, your IV line. And during the time that you're neutropenic, we have to keep you hooked up to the machine all the time. So if you're getting IVs, IV fluids, we're just leaving you hooked up, because studies have shown that the more that we disconnect, reconnect, the higher the chances that somebody could get an infection that we could have prevented. So there will usually be a handful of days that we keep you connected. So you think, well, how am I going to take my shower? How am I going to change my clothes? How am I going to do all this stuff? Your nursing staff is going to work with you to help you navigate all of that. And again, this is not long-term. The other thing that we may do during that time is have you wear a mask when you're neutropenic. We are going to have you wear a mask if you ever go off the unit for any testing, okay? We also have platelet precautions, okay? Platelets, again, are the cells that allow your blood to clot when there's an injury. And something that we have to be careful of is when we talk about you going into that trough where your blood counts get low, your platelets are going to be low. Okay. And so we don't let you bring nail clippers into the hospital, okay? Because we don't want you cutting your nails and inadvertently cutting a very vascular part of your body that could bleed a lot. We also don't want you to bring in anything but a soft toothbrush. It doesn't have to be pediatric, but it should be a soft toothbrush. No medium, no high. We don't want Sonicares or water picks or anything like that. So you're not going to be able to agitate your gums. We don't allow any flossing or picking at your gums. We don't allow straight razors. And what I mean by that is anything with an actual blade in it, okay? So you can use electric razors, but not razors with a blade. And then for platelet precautions, we're going to have you follow these fall precautions, which are coming up on another slide. We don't want you to fall for lots of different reasons. We don't want you to fall because you could potentially hurt yourself, right? And when your platelets are low, you could bleed, okay? Because you don't have the ability to clot right away. Or if someone fell and hit their head, they could have a much more serious bleed than, let's say, just falling on your elbow and getting a blood hematoma or something like that. So we have these fall precautions. And again, you're on these for a handful of days usually, where you actually have to follow all of these rules, okay? So, or we're going to help you follow them. But no bare feet. They seem like they're not slippery, but they are. Things that can increase your fall risk are also your IV pole, okay? When you're hooked up for those days, or if somebody has to have a catheter for any reason. Now, those aren't all the time, but if somebody has a catheter, that's going to increase your risk for a fall. That drop in blood pressure, the orthostatic drop, that could certainly increase your risk of falling. You're on lots of different medications that can make you sleepy, and so those could increase your risk for a fall, or just even having decreased counts can increase your risk for a fall, okay? So our interventions are making sure that you're aware that we want non-skid footwear. Sometimes we may have to use a gait belt. So if somebody's kind of dizzy and weak, we might use one of those belts that go around the waist, and we can kind of help support you as you get to the restroom, or, you know, help you walk a little bit so you're getting a little bit of exercise. We do use better chair alarms, and those are just a reminder to not get up in the middle of the night. Sometimes, you know, you forget. You think, oh yeah, I'm in the hospital, but I really need to go to the bathroom. And they get up and they go to the bathroom. well, if all of these other things were pre-existing, you could potentially fall. And so the bed alarm is to remind you, oh, wait, no, I need to call the nurse or the staff to help me get up, because it's really important that that you stay safe. And then being no more than an arm's length away from the bed. So visitors and family, depending on the time of the year or during a seasonal outbreak of a virus, we're either going to allow people to visit you or we're not going to allow people to visit you, okay? And you'll be told what the status is, okay? But when you're allowed to have visitors, we don't have specific visiting hours, okay? We do have age restrictions no matter what, and we don't allow anyone 14 years or younger on our units. No visitor should have received live vaccines within 14 days. For instance, somebody comes in and says, well, I just had my flu vaccine. And you say, well, was it a flu shot or was it a nasal spray? Because the nasal immunization is a live vaccine, whereas the shot is not. We ask that all visitors check in at the nurse's station daily to be screened. Visitors or family may spend the night when we're allowing that, okay? Always, visitors or family may not use the patient's bathroom, okay? So we have designated restrooms for visitors, and we also have a washer dryer available for visitors and for visitors to help you with your laundry. And during the restricted times, then we're gonna help you with your laundry, okay? Because we do have a washer dryer on the unit. And then we also have a shower available for family, again, when they are on the unit. So where can I walk? Can I leave the unit? You can walk on the unit, and no, you may not leave. We really do want you to get exercise during this process. So you'll be walking on the unit, and you may be walking up and down a hall many, many times, okay? To make a mile, we're gonna give you little clickers if you like to help keep track of how far you're going. In order for you to sort of set goals for your day. Some people decide that they're going to, you know, walk three times that day and they're going to walk up and down their hall, you know, 20 times each time. People have different goals depending on how they're feeling. And then our other unit is L-shaped, and so there's a little bit more variety there and it's a little bit longer. But again, just setting your goals, knowing where you're going to be and that you're not going to go through any doors that say exit, okay? Because we do want to keep you on the unit. As far as a room assignment goes, we will try to keep you in the same room during your entire hospital stay if we can. If you have increased needs and you have a higher acuity and we need to change your room to be able to accommodate that, we will do that. Or someone else may need a high acuity room and you may be able to go to a less acute area, then a less acute room, then we will do that. But we will always contact you. We will contact your family. We will pack up your belongings. We will unpack your belongings and make sure that you're tucked into your new room. So that's pretty much the inpatient stay at Presbyterian St. Luke's.